2 years ago, when we had our conference, I remember feeling quite cynical when I gave my talk, and I talked about lack of funding and how we just didn't have enough funding for research. But this time I decided I was going to take a more positive approach. And what I want to share with you is an insight into how much we have done in Utah to further research in chronic fatigue syndrome and fibromyalgia. Thousands of people have donated their biological samples and personal clinical information to advance science right here among us. Other people have donated time or money to research, and local researchers have made an indelible mark on the literature and our knowledge. And I'd like to highlight 9 types of areas of research that have gone on in Utah and commend the people who've been involved. And I think you're going to go away inspired. Maybe that you can join in additional research, or that you can congratulate some of the people that have participated. The first group I want to highlight are the patients that were part of the Ampligen study, the double-blind placebo-controlled trial of Ampligen, which is a drug for fibromyalgia. These patients had to have a Karnofsky performance score of 40 to 60. That means that's the highlighted red area. These are people that were very ill, almost too ill to come to the office to get their treatments for chronic fatigue syndrome. An IV catheter was placed to deliver the study drug, and half of the patients received a placebo drug. Twice a week, 1 to 2 hours for 40 weeks on the double blind and 24 weeks on the open label. That means the last 24 weeks, everybody received the drug. Improvement was measured by a treadmill duration at intervals before, during, and after the study. All 20 Utah patients who completed the 40 plus 24 weeks of the intravenous study drug infusions, all who enrolled completed the study. No one dropped out. They received no pay and no reimbursement, not even gas money, for participating in this trial. Unfortunately, Ampligen has still not been approved by the FDA. Around the country, there were 234 patients. 20 of those patients were from Utah, which means Utah provided 8.5% of the total enrollment, which is more than our share for a study of this size. And even though the drug wasn't approved, several important publications came from the Ampligen study data, including one that analyzing cardiopulmonary exercise study, the results that were done during the course. And the paper was called Subclassifying Chronic Fatigue Syndrome Through Exercise Testing. And this was a paper that showed an array of function in people with chronic fatigue syndrome based on their ability to exercise on a treadmill. I just want to thank those patients and tell them that they made an important contribution. This was a little study that was done, and we did it in my office. The R. Harold Burton Foundation in Salt Lake City gave $10,000 to offer, and we studied the effects of massage on patients with fibromyalgia. There were 20 patients with fibromyalgia who got a massage once a week for 12 weeks. And then there were 20 patients who came in and had their vital signs checked and tender point exam once a week, and we rewarded them with 2 massages at the end of the study. And we followed there, and neither group knew which, you know, the patients didn't know which group they were in or what the other group was getting. And this was Maggie, our massage therapist. One massage therapist did all the massages and adapted them to the patients, and we measured their tender points as well as all of their symptoms. And I just wanted to show you the outcome of this study. This is along the bottom are the weeks that they were in the study, and then up the side are the number of tender points. And if you can see the yellow lines across the top, those are the patients who did not get massage during the study. And every visit for 12 weeks, their tender points as a group stayed the same. The blue dot is the tender point total of the group before their massage, and the pink point is their tender points after the massage. So you can see that for 12 weeks, every time they got a massage, their tender points improved after the massage. And if you look over 12 weeks, it slowly goes down, 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 so that the massage we could see benefited their tender points. And many aspects of their fibromyalgia gradually improved with massage.
What kind of massage?
This was just sort of like Swedish massage, but it was adapted to the patient. So if they'd never had massage or if they were too tender, you know, she would lighten up or do more. And I will tell you that not one patient dropped out, but 2 patients said they'd never have another massage again. because their fibromyalgia was so severe that the massage increased their pain. So on average, massage was good, but there were some patients whose hyperalgesia was too intense to tolerate a massage. The third study was a study on the effects of exercise on chronic fatigue syndrome. This was done in 2005, and the CFIDS Association funded this study. They paid for University of the Pacific researchers to help carry out the study, but the patients were all from Salt Lake City. We had 20 patients with CFS and 20 healthy controls, and these patients did cardiopulmonary exercise testing. That meant they got on the bike and they exercised faster and faster with more and more resistance until they couldn't go any longer. And they gathered data on exercise and the effects of exercise on chronic fatigue patients. They looked at exercise performance, blood pressure and heart rate, symptoms after exercise, cognitive function after exercise, and they also tested RNA cell, which is that immune marker that Suzanne, Dr. Vernon was talking about. Those patients, they experienced more pain and fatigue from doing that study, but several papers came out of that study, including, and some of these were abstracts presented at conferences, but they were still published nonetheless. One was documenting post-exertional symptoms, that patients became more ill after a bout of exercise. And the second was to show that the cognitive function declined right after exercise. There was also a test within a test during this study, and some of the patients that were in this group did the cardiopulmonary testing 2 days in a row. So they did exercise to exhaustion one day and exercise to exhaustion the second day. There were additional patients that the University of Pacific included in this study, but you can see that in test one, they were both about the same, but in test two, the CFS patients were unable to duplicate their oxygen consumption. Here it is in a graph. Test one was on the first day, and test two was on the second day. It was a very important test to show that patients with CFS were unable to exert to the same level, even though they had an equal effort on the second day. The fourth study I want to tell you about, I talked about in my last talk, but this is Peggy Allen. She used to be on our offer board. Her daughter has chronic fatigue syndrome and is a patient in my clinic. Peggy was a certified nurse midwife and went on to get her advanced degree. Because of her daughter's illness, she decided she was going to write a paper about women and their healthcare providers during childbearing years. And her paper was then published in the Journal of Midwifery and Women's Health. And not only that, it was the journal's feature article. And she won a prize for the quality of her work. So this is an example of someone, just an ordinary person, who decided to go the extra mile, research the entire literature, and write a paper that is now a sentinel paper that everyone refers to. And one of the most important things we learned is there's a very small literature regarding women with chronic fatigue syndrome, and I put the references on here. I also want to say that Peggy led a panel discussion of women on CFS and childbearing issues that's on our website, if anyone would like to get on and look at that. And I also want to say that her daughter, Lauren Allen, in spite of her severe illness, went to Washington, D.C. and testified before the CFS Advisory Committee to the Department of Health and Human Services about the impact of CFS on her education, which was a very courageous thing for her to do. The fifth research I want to mention, and this is really a large group of research, but there are clinical drug trials that have led to FDA approval of 3 drugs for the treatment of fibromyalgia pain, and I think we are all familiar with those FDA-approved drugs for fibromyalgia. I want you to know that hundreds of people in Utah with fibromyalgia have helped during these clinical trials and are continuing to volunteer to be research subjects. In my research department alone, in my office, 433 times, men and women. The reason I say times is some people did it more than once, participated in more than one trial. So it was hard to count exactly how many people they were, but participated in pharmaceutical trials. More than 340 of those people with fibromyalgia went off all their medications. That means medications for pain, for sleep, and for mood, to participate in double-blind placebo-controlled trials of these new medications before they were approved by the FDA. The remaining people were part of a study that tracked fibromyalgia symptoms and the medications they used. But this is a significant contribution to research by people in Utah. And that's just my research department alone. Similar participation occurred, for example, in the office of Dr. N. Lee Smith at the Life Tree Pain Clinic and other locations in Utah. That is more than all of you in this room multiplied by three or four times who volunteered, who became subjects in order to understand the safety and efficacy of these drugs.
What are the three medications that have been approved for fibromyalgia?
Lyrica, Savella, and Cymbalta, in answer to your question specifically. Clinical drug trials establish the efficacy and safety of a new drug, or the use of a familiar drug for a new condition, or use in a different population. FDA approval of drugs for fibromyalgia gave a huge boost to the credibility and awareness of this illness and prompted a multi-million pharma campaign toward the education of medical providers about fibromyalgia. Everything has changed in the last 3 years in terms of the awareness of primary care physicians about fibromyalgia, mostly because of the approval of these drugs. And the approval of these drugs happened because of volunteerism, because of patients who are ill, who are willing to go participate in clinical trials. And I want to tell you that trials of these three drugs are anticipated in the pediatric age group, and they're either expected or currently enrolling. And if you're interested in pharmaceutical trials, there are several booths out in the area where you can discuss that with several clinics. And not all of them are involving the use of pharmaceuticals. Some of them are doing other kinds of activities. But participating in research is one of the greatest ways to make the field move forward. All right, number six is I wanted to highlight the academic and NIH-funded studies of fibromyalgia by Dr. Akiko Okafuji's team up at the University of Utah. They don't do as many pharma trials, but they have been studying behavior, hormones, and other kind of interventions for patients with fibromyalgia. And in anticipation of this, I asked her about her recent studies, and I looked up, and there's a brief report in Clinical Rheumatology, and two papers are in press in the Journal of Pain, one of the most major journals for chronic pain research, and a great place to put articles for fibromyalgia. One is on the relationship between obesity and fibromyalgia-related symptoms, pain, functioning, and other fibromyalgia symptoms. And another is on sequential analyses, testing how pain, fatigue, and emotion may influence each other over time. And I actually put her name in Medscape, and many papers came up. I didn't know how much publications had come out of her work, but this was just since 2006, these major papers that have come from the University of Utah. And I'll tell you that Dr. Okafuji was on the team that invented Tenderpoint, the Tenderpoint exam, with Dr. Dennis Turk. She was on the team that did the studies that established that Tenderpoints would distinguish fibromyalgia as a condition. Her team is currently finishing up a project evaluating activation therapy. That means getting moving. You know, when you stop doing things because of your pain, everything gets worse. And so they're doing a study on activation therapy combined with various other behavioral approaches that has more than 300 patients enrolled. And they're also doing more studies on the effect of weight gain in fibromyalgia and helping patients overcome that very difficult problem of, you know, being in pain and fatigue and gaining weight and having trouble exercising. So her group has a booth outside, and you can learn more about participating in their studies.